everything started with this place in June 1940. But 1 year later, this country was finally served. Another German spinner houses and the large houses. And now the side of the other side of the land is one.
Thank you. monumental piece of equipment.
There are pictures on the right side. The section for the women was created in Birkenau. Like it's only 1941, when they were suffering one. All their pictures are pictures of the men. On the unicorns, you could see number and a triangle.
Before going to work, before leaving the room in the morning, you have to understand the look of the toilet and the washrooms. They are
Thank you.
is that the main sector that is behind the internal vehicle is practically empty, like there are practically no barracks yet, because they were all barracks are still present at the very beginning of the sector, but the rest of them was dismantled when the war finished. Because first of all, people that came back here, citizens of this area, were put into their houses and removed the material. Secondly, all of them are spread over the point, also the material. And also they were very hard to maintain, they were very precarious. So after all, the whole wood was taken, and the only thing that you have are the brick parts. So the foundations were added later, and the original
thank you. barracks. It's one of the empty spots where you can see that there used to be something. There were also wooden barracks, but they were just single barracks added later. Generally, this this part was from brick. And in Auschwitz, when we entered the block, you saw the rooms and also the washrooms inside the block. Here in Birkenau, the situation was different because the washrooms were located outside of the barracks. But the rule was generally the same, morning, evening, officially, and during the day, the washrooms were closed. And here they are also divided. The first long block, there were toilets, but and you can take in the second if you want to look through a window because they are closed. There was no canalization system here in Birkenau, so there was a lack of water very often. Women that as first were located in Birkenau, for the first year they lived here with no water at all, because also the washrooms were not immediately here when people were brought here to Birkenau, so everything was developing with time. Later there was an idea to create a canalization system, and they even started, but it was never finished. So somebody also had to clean the toilet as well, and there was a special commander that was doing it. It was an awful job, obviously, because it was smelly and it's not pleasant, but it was not that bad after all, because it was so unpleasant that no Germans wanted to really enter this place. So they watched them from outside, they didn't beat them, they didn't hear to everything they said. And these people, as the only ones, could use the toilet whenever they wanted, and they could be there alone. Well, everybody else had to go there all together, and it was very, very humiliating for them and hard. So you may take a look through the window, and then we will pass to the next one where there were sinks.
Thank you.
with no foundations. There was no pavement inside. Right now there are this wooden, there is the wooden floor, because it was very uneven and a little bit dangerous for us to walk. But underneath you will be possible to see it. There is practically ground. So when it was raining again, or when it was snowing, or there were bad weather conditions outside, and prisoners were moving between the barrack and the outside, they were bringing all of the stuff inside the barrack. So there was a mud, there was snow, there was water inside the barrack. There are 3-story beds, but in this case, 5 people approximately slept on each level, not 2 as it was in Auschwitz. And the lower level was also used. So they practically again slept on the ground. And there was no particular rule, simply who was stronger, healthier, could go up, had better place. Those that were ill, mostly those that suffered for diarrhea, for example, they slept obviously on the ground level. And you know that the washrooms were outside. People couldn't really change their clothes, couldn't really wash them, so they were all the time dirty. They were cold, of course, in the winter, and in the summer it was very hot because the barracks couldn't open. The windows couldn't open. As we said, there was a canal, the heating system, but it was rarely used, if it was used at all. So the temperature was quite similar to the temperature outside, plus 700 people inside. We have to consider it. Maybe sometimes even 1,000. Depends on the moment of, on the situation, on the moment of the war, how many deportees were coming here to the camp. And there are obviously no washrooms inside the barrack because they are already outside. So as we enter, you will see also 2 tiny rooms on the left and on the right by the entrance. In one there was a guardian, in this case a female guardian, and in the other the bread was stored that was in the evening given to prisoners. So we'll enter, we'll walk around, okay, and then 2 more words here outside.
Thank you.
Dangerous because it's not even, but mostly those between the barracks are original. Okay, so two more words about this particular barrack, because it looks like practically all of the barracks in this part, in the woman part, but this one was called the death barrack again, because it had another function. It was not only the living barrack, it was mostly a barrack where women, after being selected as not able to work anymore, were sent if they couldn't be sent immediately to the gas chamber. If you remember the selections that we talked in Auschwitz about, like in the hospital, it was the same here, like people were getting ill and so on, so at some point they were not able to work anymore and they were destined to die. But sometimes the gas chambers were working and they couldn't send them directly there. And in this case there was a barrack like this with a courtyard. And these women were placed inside the barrack, or if the barrack was full, they were placed also at the courtyard outside and left. They had to wait for their turn to go to the gas chambers. In the meantime, usually they were dying, because once they were brought here, they were already crossed out from the list, so they were not getting any more food, anything to drink. They were also left here naked and with no covers, of course. So usually they were dying in the meantime, especially if it was cold. That's why the name of this particular bar. So the camp was liberated on 27th of January 1945 by Soviet army. But when the Soviets arrived, the camp was practically empty because Germans tried to evacuate the camp. And 10 days earlier, there was the total evacuation. So they took everyone that was still able to walk in so-called death marches, because it was January, plenty of snow, cold, and they forced these people, approximately 55,000 of people, to walk from this place to different cities in Silesia, sometimes 50-60 kilometers, from which they were supposed to be transported by trucks to Germany to be still used in the camps over there as a cheap labor. So during these marches, obviously many people died. We don't know exactly how many, but when Soviets arrived, they found 7,000 people. Among them, they found almost 700 children of different ages, mostly Polish children, Ukrainian, Belarusian, that were placed here in Birkenau in a special barrack for children, and survived the liberation because they were brought here after the Warsaw Uprising in 1944. So they spent only a few months here. That's why they managed to survive. They were left here because they were too weak to walk. And also the others that were left were only those that were sick or very, very weak. So when Soviets arrived, they liberated those that were still alive, because they arrived after 10 days. And they found some things that you saw in Auschwitz, like some items, but not many if we think about 5 years of the existence of the camp. Because Germans tried to destroy all the documents, they destroyed the gas chambers and everything that was possible to cover all the traces of their crimes. In 1947, and this place became a museum so very fast, I think, after the war. It was the idea of former prisoners that survived the war. They wanted to maintain this place to show it to the next generations. They were the first guides in the museum. The director of the camp till a few years ago was always an ex-prisoner, but of course many years have passed, so we have every day we have less of them. But every year on 27th of January, the museum celebrates the liberation of the camp here in Birkenau. And there are still some former prisoners that are alive that come here because they want to spend this day together with other people in this place, and sometimes they give some short speeches. So thank you for coming here, for visiting this place, for learning about the history of these people, and of course if you have any questions you can ask us now. No? Okay, so thank you so much. Thank you for your help. If anything comes to your mind, maybe right now when we are going to exit, you can of course approach. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you're going to see me.